السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Dear Professor Sami and all the professors and doctors and participants who are with us here at Ibn Khaldun conference room and all those who are joining on the Zoom platform and also the YouTube channel. Welcome to our distinguished lecture today. Alhamdulillah, with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are having with us today Professor Sami Dagestani. And I think if you Google his name, you will find that his contributions and his works on Islamic thought, Islamic economics, are really very special and a kind of a quality kind of works, not just any publications. We are very much honored at ISTEC here, especially under the series of distinguished lectures coordinated by Dr. Nurul Ain. I think this is already number, what number is this lecture? Number 8. Means there were 7 scholars already invited to this distinguished lecture series, which started in the middle of last year. Alhamdulillah. And I think I thank all the professors and doctors and our postgraduate student and our professors from UIA also for coming and participating in this. I think the topic is very important. Very like interdisciplinary topic, economic philosophy of Al-Ghazali, ethics, law, and the pursuit of happiness. It's really a very good topic. Without any delay, I would like to ask Professor Dr. Ain to moderate this distinguished lecture. Go ahead, Sister Ain.
Thank you, Professor Aziz. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the ISTEC Distinguished Scholar Lecture Series number 8 on a topic that bridges the realms of economic philosophy, ethics, and Islamic intellectual history. And as we dwell, you can't hear? As we delve into this intriguing subject, it is my distinct honor to introduce our speaker, Dr. Sami Al-Daghestani. So Dr. Al-Daghestani is not only a distinguished academic, but a bridge builder between cultures and disciplines. He holds a PhD in Islamic studies from Leiden University with co-supervision at Columbia University and currently serves as a postdoctoral fellow at the Norwegian School of Theology, Religion and Society. His scholarly pursuit extends as an associate faculty at the Brooklyn Institute for Social Research and as a research scholar at the Middle East Institute, Columbia University. So Dr. Al-Daghestani's work is a testament to his passion for Islamic intellectual history and its intersection with economics, environment, and ethics, alongside a keen interest in Islam's dialogue with modernity. And he has also scholarly contributions include editing 2 pivotal books on the Second Gulf War and Middle Eastern culture, translating similar works like Ibn Battuta's Rihla and Ibn Tufail's Hey Ibn Yaqzan to Slovenian. And he knows 6 languages and authoring groundbreaking publications such as Abu Hamid al-Ghazali's Ethical Teachings, Economics of Happiness, and The Making of Islamic Economic Thought. So today we have we have an honor to have him here with us today, and the floor is yours, Dr. Daghestani.
Bismillah. Thank you so much for having me. It's a true pleasure to be with you this afternoon. I would like to especially thanks Professor Berghout, as well as Professor Hanif, who is not with us today, and Professor Norman for really kindly facilitating this lecture, especially on such a short notice. Maybe a week ago or so, we initiated the organization. It's a pleasure to present my work at your institute, and I look forward to engaging with the students and other colleagues and friends as well. Before I start, I just want to say that I've been following ISTAC's activities for quite some time, since my graduate studies in Leiden, so it's a true pleasure to be with you today. What I will discuss is Al-Ghazali's economic philosophy. And I would like to point out that his ideas on economic thought, more specifically, point to what I call, or presents rather a pinnacle of what I call the ethical economic genre in Islamic tradition. Al-Ghazali and scholars like him who come from a similar tradition thought of economics and what we as moderns obviously call economic science. So we have to take obviously some type of distancing from that term and concept itself. So thought of what we call economics as a human science, in a human science that is intricately related to other fields, associated, for instance, with ethical, ecological, but also cosmological understanding of the universe, right? So other fields would transpass, obviously, Sufism, philosophy, kalam, law, and so on and so forth. Reading Al-Ghazali's economic passages, then, presupposes also a critique of a positivistic theories or approaches to economic science. So that it's very technical in nature, right? Whereas Al-Ghazali's thought, as we shall see, is really focused on the ethical and moral endeavors of human beings. Now, these modern approaches to theory present a rather, in my opinion, a very, very narrow interpretation of economic life that is usually either based on mathematics or free market economy, and both of which would go against the very ethical teachings that is put forward by Al-Ghazali and his ilk, so scholars that come from the same tradition around the same time, from 9th to 13th and beyond centuries. So in few selected writings by classical scholars, economic issues, economic predicaments cannot be studied on their own terms, but in relation to other human endeavors and sciences. So I would like to explore pre-modern economic thought in Islamic tradition. And really, I would like to invite us to rethink the importance of classical economic genre, because these accounts are obviously extremely important, not only for those who study Islamic sciences or Islamic history specifically, but also for historians and economists themselves. Why? Because I think that economic issues cannot be solved by economists themselves, right? Al-Ghazali presents then a culmination, one could say, of the so-called ethical economics, providing analytical approaches to economic activities that is based both on philosophical reasoning on one hand and Sufi principles on the other hand. And he has been building these ideas from scholars that came prior to him, such as Al-Muhasibi, to some extent Ibn Abil al-Dunya, but also Al-Isfahani, most notably. In essence, Al-Ghazali teaches that one way of recovering ethics in current debates on modern economic issues is indeed to resort back to Islamic intellectual heritage, that very heritage that also helped shape the modern world in which we live in, especially its moral philosophy. Now, I would like to delve into some of Al-Ghazali's major points on law, happiness, and economics. And before I do that, I will just briefly provide the context of Al-Ghazali's intellectual path in relation to his own opus. As we know, Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali made seminal contributions to the fields of kalam, falsafa, tasawwuf, but also usul al-fiqh. And he wrote many chapters in his opus magnum, Ihya ul-Din, on economic conduct. In order to position Al-Ghazali's economic philosophy within his overall work, I think we have to think of him as a scholar of heterogeneity. What I mean by that is obviously a quality of being diverse in character, in being diverse in his intellectual output, in that he worked at the intersection of various fields, various domains that are nowadays usually understood as having a separate epistemology. And that would include, for instance, Sufi mysticism or Sufi mystical tradition, philosophy, theology, and Islamic law. So his overall theory on the ethics of happiness, which I will discuss in a few moments, or sa'ada, is based on ideas and reasoning from all these diverse fields. His theoretical accounts on economic thought can be found in some of his major works, including Yahya al-Umidin, the already mentioned, but also Mizan al-Amal, which is a rather shorter work on ethics, and Nasihat al-Muluk, usually regarded as a mirror for princes, right? By merging then kasb and zuhd, kasb as the notion of acquisition of wealth, how to make a living, and zuhd, renouncing the world, right? Two usually opposing concepts. Under the banner of tawakkul, so under the banner of trusting God, Al-Ghazali then develops economic thought as part of his overall theory of happiness. And that theory of happiness is very much linked to his concept, and this is a technical term, the science of the hereafter, right? Ilm tariq al-akhirah. So Ihya covers both theoretical and practical aspects, or one could say the science of praxis, ilm al-mu'amala, and the science of unveiling, ilm al-mukashafa. Now the science of praxis, ilm al-mu'amala, think of it as outward knowledge, something that is to be learned, knowledge of transactions. It includes obviously other people, other human beings, right? Ilm al-mukashafa is believed to be of Sufi origins. It's based on self-knowledge. In other words, transactional knowledge leads towards ilm al-mukashafa, or the knowledge of unveiling. While Munqid min ad-Dalal is often regarded as al-Ghazali's work in Sufism, this cannot be obviously said with certainty for Ihya al-Umidin. Even though one can find obviously many theological, not only theological, but also Sufi currents and undertones in various volumes. For Kenneth Garden, for instance, Ihya is not a work on Sufism, even though it makes references to earlier Sufi works as well. Then we can think of Ihya perhaps first and foremost as being positioned at the intersection of both philosophical reasoning and Sufi epistemology, in whose essence is desires of the path towards the hereafter, ilm tariq al-akhirah, which is achieved through the ethics of happiness or sa'ada. There are a handful of scholars who deal with al-Ghazali's economics. I think worth mentioning are Muhammad Ghazanfar and Abdullah Islahi. Their texts on al-Ghazali also in part informed and inspired my own work. But also the works from Professor Dr. Adi Setia, his translations of al-Ghazali's passages into English, who really brings to light the ethical and mystical aspects of his work. Nonetheless, the overall negligence of al-Ghazali's economic contributions, I think, goes hand in hand with a claim that classical economic, Islamic economic scholarship did not offer any significant development in the field of economics, which I think would be historically incorrect, in what was in Europe during that time called, obviously, the Middle Ages, right? We know that this is a very Eurocentric approach to world history. Before going head-on on economic ideas, I will touch upon the notion of law and happiness in al-Ghazali's work. Now on, and here you have obviously first the visualization, if you will, of, you know, the ultimate aim of ilm tariq al-akhirah and how kasb as acquisition of wealth on one hand and zuh, renouncing the world, really contribute towards ilm tariq al-akhirah under the banner of tawakkul or trusting God. In light of al-Ghazali's philosophical ethical epistemology, I think it would be safe to state that economic thought does not arrive from fiqh literature alone, or even more specifically fiqh al-mu'amala, even though it has become a very important branch of Islamic law. But Islamic law was not always historically centered on economic technical matters. If we think of Sharia as a divine immutable law within the context of Quranic, let's say, normative teachings, is closely associated with ethical considerations also for economic life. And this pertains to questions such as purchases, sales, commodities, how to obtain food, how to use shelter, how to utilize money and other activities. So all of this is part of Al-Ghazali's project on self-accountability. This means that not all economic-related teachings and activities can or should be studied within the legal discourse alone. Al-Ghazali claims that fiqh, for instance, used to be part of the sciences of the hereafter as an ethical category, first and foremost. Only later in Islamic history, it became associated with jurisprudence more properly. So the very term fiqh is part of religious sciences, ulum ad-din. And he says, quote, if we attach fiqh to the path of the science of the hereafter, it becomes honorable, end of quote. Or later on, he states in Mustasfa that fiqh, quote, has become a specialized branch of fatwas and waqfs on small details about them and excessive debates surrounding them. The meaning of fiqh in the first Islamic period, that is, however, was undisputedly linked to the science of the path of the hereafter, knowledge of the details of harmful matters of the self, that which corrupts human action, understanding of indulging in the wickedness of the world, perseverance for reaching the grace of the hereafter, and God's fierce domination over the heart. End of quote. So the very engagement with law, what we moderns call law, obviously Sharia, necessitates an ethical subjectivity that extends to economic life, commerce, and finance. Al-Ghazali even labeled the legal specialists of his time, or fuqaha, as the scholars of the world, ulama ad-dunya. He positioned law rather in the service of higher goals. And this view very much appertains also to his ethics of happiness. Now, thinking about what exactly is happiness or felicity in English, or sa'ada in the context of his work, his book, Mizan al-Amal, or The Scale of Action, is a rather short work on ethics. And it really begins with a call to pursue happiness in the hereafter. And he says that felicity or happiness is not the same as salvation, which most believers hope to attain, but rather it's a state of pleasure that surpasses the pleasure of the saved in the hereafter. Happiness then depends on the usage of our own faculties, such as reason, imagination, belief, and so forth, but also, Al-Ghazali would say, by emulating historical figures in Islamic tradition. It can be achieved through self-examination, muhasabah, and also possessing self-knowledge, by recognizing that one's heart is really pure, and then with time it becomes contaminated by the pursuits of various desires. In other words, then, sa'ada is the ethics of contentment. It is based both on ethical psychology and the teachings of tasawwuf by using conceptualizations from both traditions. As Al-Ghazali states, then, quote, the source of sa'ada in this world and the hereafter is ilm. And usually we translate ilm as science, but obviously we know that it's much more complex and polyvalent than what the English term implies. So this means that the science of the hereafter is the highest aim of eternal happiness. Now, this is where economics becomes, I think, not only important, but really a key component of his thought. All human activity, including economic engagements, are geared towards a higher end, right? And since acquiring knowledge is inextricably related to its practice, and I will come to that in a few moments, Ihya can also be depicted as a referential book on how to perform obtained knowledge, or demonstrative proof, burhan. So Ihya is not only theoretical work per se, but it really points to the fact that knowledge must be put into practice. A virtuous or purified soul, for instance, follows both the revealed moral law, Sharia more specifically, and philosophical, ethical postulates of human reasoning. Eternal happiness then is attained by combining ilm as knowledge or science, if you will, and amal as informed practice, especially in the field of economic thought, which constitutes a very important component of his theory of happiness. This brings us then more closely, and here again you have the visualization of how self-knowledge and self-examination, muhasaba, is really geared towards the notion of sa'ada, the eternal happiness, which again, whose ultimate aim is al-tariq al-akhirah. This brings us then to Al-Ghazali's economic philosophy. Now, despite that he makes many normative statements about righteous living, and by normative statements, I mean how one should or should not behave, when one should or should not do, and so forth, he nonetheless systematizes his economic thought into several fields. And I try to weave through some of these normative and technical accounts of his work. Most of his ideas of economics are to be found in the second volume of Ihya, and he discusses these issues predominantly in the third book of the second volume, entitled Manners of Earning a Livelihood, or Adab al-Kasb wal-Ma'ash, although his economic ideas are obviously much more dispersed through various texts. Four chapters in this book are specifically intended to address economic theory and financial issues: the nature of work, lawful means of earning concerning business, trade, and exchange, then justice, equity, and fairness in gaining livelihood, such as cheating, counterfeiting of coins, hoarding, overpricing commodities, and so forth, and benevolence and piety in trading and economic activities. His economic thought then can be divided into several themes that would span ethical jurisprudence, the notion of maslaha, the well-being, division of labor and the development of markets, but also the final two, the function and the role of money or wealth, and the role of hizba. And I will take the role of money as one case study, if time allows, because obviously mal in classical Arabic would mean something beyond money, right? It would mean money, but also wealth. And wealth is obviously, again, a broader concept than only money. Hizba as well. Hizba could be translated as governmental authority. And we will come to that when we look into his activities and how buyers and sellers should act in the market. What exactly is Hizba, the role of Hizba, of governmental authority, and in what instances the Hizba really intervenes, right? In Ihya, Al-Ghazali develops what I call the ethical economic subjectivity, which is for him really encapsulated in his overall human experience, that it's based on the idea that the soul is the essence of selfhood, and it really serves the divine, right, the divine law. So the problem with terms such as economics and finance, obviously, is the technical connotation that it's usually brought forth. And I would want us to think, or at least to step one distance ahead, so to speak, from this technical understanding of the term of economics, because it does not imply only technical issues of jurisprudence or finance, or even doesn't have to deal with numbers, but something that much more pertains to ethical and moral composition of the human being, right? Now, if we look at two cases, one would be money or mal, and the other would be poverty or faqr. And I think these are very important for his overall theory on economic thought. Mal or money became a source or a tool of exploitative practices in the caliphate in the 11th and 12th century, despite, one would claim, the emergence of many classical works on economic thought that would address Sufi and ethical and even philosophical views on money as a medium of exchange. However, those classical works point to the ethical shortcomings, one could argue, of governmental officials of the day. And Al-Ghazali, even though he belonged to the elite There is no denying there. He also delivered a critique of governmental officials and learned men of the day, right? And this might be, for some scholars, this is one of the reasons, for instance, why he left Baghdad and the prestigious Nizamiya Madrasa and embark on his sort of ethical journey, if you will. But money or wealth is perceived as one of the most important inventions in economic affairs. And for Al-Ghazali, it's rendered both as a benefit, but also a detriment, if not handled right. So it depends on the human purposes and the human intentions, right? It depends on niyyah. Al-Ghazali regards wealth as dangerous in one respect, because it cannot completely satisfy anyone, something called hubbul mal, right? The love for wealth, the love for money. Even if one possesses immense wealth, right? He says, well, there is no end to it. But conversely, mal includes also spiritual, bodily, and material benefits. However, it is only a means to an end and never an end in itself. And I think this is one of the major takeaways from his theory on mal, right? Mal is to be used as a medium of exchange, as a bridge, so to speak, but never as an aim in and of itself. For instance, this is again the twofold perspective that Al-Ghazali delivers. He says, quote, wealth is the biggest temptation of them all, right? But then in the same breath, he says, the worldly wealth is good for a good man. So on one hand, wealth is something that we have to be cautious of. But on the other hand, it can be extremely beneficial if it's handled correctly. Wealth is only a means to achieve higher ends, never an end in itself, or a medium of exchange. In other words, money has to be utilized for the benefit of the society or for one to sustain oneself. The reason why one loves to accumulate wealth, for Al-Ghazali, is high aspirations for and the illusion that the wealth is everlasting. This is why commodities, for instance, should never be praised. And we know that in market economy, this is exactly what we're dealing with, is overpraising of commodities, right? He says, for instance, quote, dirhams and dinars, so the silver dirhams and the gold dinars, are not created for any specific reason. They are without value in themselves and are like stones. Rather, they are created for circulation from person to person in order to promote transactions, end of quote. So this twofold approach of mal, a tool to secure righteous life and as a mechanism or a tool, again, to counteract human inclination for lust, really depends on one's objectives concerning wealth. Money is beneficial if it's spent, for instance, for religious endeavors, but not only for religious endeavors, also other necessities that could lead towards securing these religious endeavors. And that would include, obviously, food, shelter, clothing, investments, and so on and so forth. Mal can be spent for, quote, whatever is necessary for the accomplishment of a wajib, right? Whenever is necessary for the accomplishment of that which is necessary, end of quote. So there are two types of compulsory spending: spending in the name of Sharia, in the name of divine law, and on the other hand, spending out of own chivalry, marwa, or habit, al-ada. And if one does not spend in either way, so neither in the name of Sharia, nor in the name of marwa, nor in the name of al-ada, then one is regarded as a miser. And as you might know, miserliness then is condemned because it can lead to tyranny if it's not handled correctly. So activities that are regarded as harmful to individuals or society at large, despite their widespread existence, are to be avoided. And some of these examples are hoarding of wealth, hoarding of food supplies, hoarding of medicine, counterfeiting of coins, and not disclosing the true price of a commodity. Next example is poverty or faqr. Again, it's a term that it's multivalent, that it's complex, it's not unidimensional or monodimensional. And by faqr, I mean both socioeconomic poverty, which is obviously not highly regarded, and by that I mean financial impoverishment, but neither is highly regarded lust for money, right, on the other hand. minimum economic gain is sometimes frowned upon because it can mean simply a lack of economic participation by individuals in society. And this could obviously lead to disbelief, or it can bring about social instability in society. And what is remedy for Al-Ghazali? Well, it's moderation, kifaya, which is encouraged as a preferred standard of living, right? On the other hand, however, poverty has to be abrogated. But by poverty, by faqr, Al-Ghazali means here the socioeconomic poverty, right? This is one component of poverty. The other component is poverty as in spiritual means, in spiritual sense, spiritual poverty that can be considered as a spiritual component over riches. So again, the twofold understanding of poverty. More than what is needed, right? He would say it's poison. And he says poverty, quote, is not to possess what is necessary by removing wants, so by removing desires. Not having that which is necessary is not considered poverty. If you have that which is necessary and have a command over it, you're not poor, end of quote. So why? Because you know how to handle your possessions. And then in Ihya, he again states that poverty comes in five ways. There is poverty of the one who renounces the world. So again, the notion of zuhd comes in play, which is regarded as the highest level, because one obviously does not indulge in riches. Second, poverty of the one who does not despise wealth, but possesses more than what is necessary. Thirdly, poverty of the one who loves wealth, but does not strive to obtain it. Fourth, poverty of the greedy who desire to earn more wealth. And finally, poverty of the one who strives for wants, yet has no possession of wealth. So faqr as an ethical merit, right? Faqr is really an ethical merit and not simply a matter of financial or economic destitution or impoverishment. This brings us then to a few examples of economic activities of Al-Ghazali's thought. For instance, he says that trader should be honest in his deeds and one should learn his living by real work as a sign of his piety. Proper work is obviously perceived as a sign of tawakkul or trusting God. And he states that one should not buy from a merchant who is monopolizing the market or jacking up the prices of a particular commodity or good. On the flip side, the seller should not sell a commodity to a person who is either a minor, mentally ill, a slave, someone who is blind, or to someone who makes illicit or unlawful gains. Why? Because this obviously clearly undermines the ethical rulings of fair economic conduct. Similarly, one should not perform trade activities with the following individuals for obvious reasons pertaining to their lack of ethical and moral predisposition. And these would be a tyrant, a usurer, so a person who is engaging in usury or riba, a person who provides false accounts, a thief, a person who indulges in bribery, or a person of doubtful character. So for Al-Ghazali, there should be no fraud in weights of quantities in determining the price of a commodity, right? Because why? Decency is to, and decency and honesty are to be expected. In other words, the principle of justice must be facilitated in the marketplace. If a buyer, for instance, offers a higher price than the price on the market, the seller has the right not to accept it, even though he's offered a particular good. Why? Because the excess of profit might occur. The excess of profit might occur. So Al-Ghazali upholds that ihsan has to be practiced in the market as an act of generosity. And this very much pertains to his idea of just price. Now we can ask, what exactly is just price? Has there been a theory of just price in pre-modern Islamic world or for Al-Ghazali specifically? And by reading Al-Ghazali, but also other scholars, one can then conclude and say that just price is the prevalent price on the market for a specific good, right? That which is sort of the normal, the regular price. Anything that goes like higher could be regarded as illicit or unlawful, right? And then the buyer has the right to avoid that purchase. Similarly is the case with riba, and I'm not discussing the notion of riba in detail. Riba usually translated as usury or excessive usury should be, according to Al-Ghazali and many other scholars as well, prohibited or illicit. Why? Because money has to circulate, right? This is one of his major points. Money has to be put in circulation. Usury or riba would mean an end to its function. Why? Because the process, you have to know the process of selling and purchasing a commodity in advance. And if you don't know that process, you might end up with having an excessive gain, which could be perceived as falling under the category of riba. To conclude, if one gathers this quite diverse opus of Al-Ghazali, you have Mizan al-Amal on one hand as works of ethics. You have Yahya as both philosophical and Sufi context. And then you have Nasihat al-Muluk, which is seen as mirror for princes. And it has been also critically assessed by many scholars whether it fully belongs to Al-Ghazali or not. We see that in essence, these works are about ethics, whereas philosophy for Yahya or politics for Nasihat al-Muluk comes second in place. So the notion of kasb, as Al-Ghazali uses it, again, often translated as economics, which I think would do injustice to the very concept, entails qualities of ilm al-mu'amala and ilm al-mukashafa and does not convey only economic growth that is usually associated with the science of economics in modern era and modern times. Or the same goes for the notion of iqtisad more closely translated as economics per se, right? So iqtisad and kasb should be in the service of wider social and ethical postulates. So given his religious, intellectual, as well as spiritual investment in attaining the ethics of happiness, it might be safe to state that Al-Ghazali was in essence an ethicist, much more than a philosopher per se, or a theologian, or a Sufi, or a legal scholar in this narrow sense of the word. Or rather that his ethics is a result of a conjunction between and among those various traditions. Most of his ideas on the so-called ethical economic thought or genre build upon both philosophical reasoning and the teachings of Sufism or Tasawwuf, and are part of his overall attempt to really purify the qalb, right? Purification of the heart, what al-Makki would call taharat al-qulub, right? As well as to revive, obviously, the lost, what he would call the lost sciences of the day, right? Now, there is also a notion of applicability that I think is central to his thought, whether the ideas, the philosophical ideas that come with al-Ghazali are to be applied in real life society, and if so, to what extent, or I'll only use sort of for, you know, museum theory, so to speak. If we think of eternal happiness or sa'ada as infinite pleasure that could be or should be rather combined with ilm al-amal in the field of economics, then it means that instead of demarcating Sufism or tasawwuf as a branch of Islam that only presents the inner worldly mysticism, Al-Ghazali and many other classical scholars would argue that zuhd, as renunciation of the world, is very much linked to kasb, the proper acquisition and engagement in society, in the world, right? So the kasb and zuhd are sort of indispensable. They go actually hand in hand. Kalam then, as systematic theology, Sharia as a divine law, form part of the sciences of praxis, of ilm al-mu'amala. But again, knowledge of these sciences has no value in itself. It has value only insofar if it's actively applied in practice. So in this rather specific reading of Al-Ghazali's thought, he conceived an economic analysis that was found upon ethics and teachings, an endeavor that should be ultimately regarded as what I would call the technology of self-examination, that it has to do as much with economic financial matters as with innerworldly ethical and moral dispositions. And I do believe that he remains highly relevant for today's discussions on economics, finance, and applied ethics as well. With that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I very much look forward to your comments and questions. Thank you so much again.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Samyal Dagestani, for your wonderful presentation and very, very beneficial insight. So as we see Al-Ghazali's fusion of fiqh, Sufi philosophy and sa'ada and ethics, it remains relevant in the modern world as it addresses the contemporary quest for meaning, for ethical guidance and spiritual fulfillment amidst the complexities of globalization, technological advancement, and cultural pluralism. His emphasis on inner spiritual transformation and ethical integrity offers a timeless framework for individuals seeking to navigate moral challenges, cultivate inner peace, and contribute positively to society, serving as a source of inspiration and guidance in fostering personal well-being, social cohesion, and ethical leadership in the modern age. Okay, now we open the floor for questions here in the conference room, as well as our online participation. Please.
Yeah, can I just
sure.
Start? I think this is really something good to hear from Dr. Sami, and we see another dimension of this great mind of Al-Ghazali and how he articulated a kind of an economic theory within the his concepts of ethics, tasawuf, akhlaq, ulum al-din, maqasid al-sharia. This is really something good that our student, especially postgraduate student, need to explore and look at this economic. It's like a concept from interdisciplinary perspective when he looked at the economy and related to ma'ash, related to maslaha, related to amal, related to desires, related to akhira, related to dunya, related to nasihatul muluk, related to many things. That's the how this genius mind of Al-Ghazali. Prof, I wanted just to check whether, because towards the end of your lecture, you were saying that still relevant. So can you expand more on this idea of the relevance of Al-Ghazali's approach to economy in a very sophisticated life where we are living today, and whether the topics and the areas, the issues that he raised there are still relevant, other than the part of values and ethics? As you know now, the economy is in a very different situation and very complicated, very sophisticated, and so on and so forth. So that relevance of Al-Ghazali views on economy and how they are related to happiness and sa'ada is very important. Whether our current economy now leads us to sa'ada or leads us somewhere else, whether our understanding of poverty today is like how Al-Ghazali articulated the concept of poverty in that model which he has done. Yeah.
Yes, thank you so much, Professor. This is a very good point. And this is what I get usually often, looking at the question, namely, when it comes to someone like Al-Ghazali, who comes from 12th century, so completely different world, completely different era, to what extent can we make use of Al-Ghazali in modern times? And I would say two things. One, is he relevant? Yes. Has he been, and other scholars, picked up to the level that he, in my opinion, deserves? No. In other words, there is an immense space still left to include scholars such as Al-Ghazali or Al-Muhasibi or Al-Isfahani and their views on economic ethical teachings in our modern times. Now, what I mean by that and how to be done, one is simply through reading. By reading these scholars, by including them in modern curricula, that would be actually a start. And second, I think including them into the works of classical scholars that we found, for instance, in Euro-America or in the West, that would actually challenge the very norms of what, number one, what constitutes economics and how different it is or was for the pre-modern scholars. And two, it also challenges the very division of sciences with which we're living today, right? Division of sciences between the natural and the social sciences, and then within that, humanities versus social sciences and so forth. Obviously, the division of sciences, as we follow today, have much in common with a particular vision of how the world functions, and it's to an extent Eurocentric in nature, right? So if we put forth, let's say, Al-Ghazali's division of sciences, we come to a very different understanding, whereby economic thought, it's not theorized on its own merit, but it's very much included into the ethical, philosophical, and Sufi postulates, right? So it actually opens up a completely different space, I think, to re-envision or to reimagine what exactly is economics. So the fact that we have a self-standing science of economics today is equally wonderful and concerning, in my opinion, right? Because it sort of it disparages, it sets aside the ethical endeavors that, in my opinion, have to be incorporated very much when you come to financializations, questions of commodity purchases, inheritance laws, and so on and so forth, right? So have these scholars been picked up to the level they desire, they acquire? No. There is much work to be done. But these are, I think, broader questions that really pertain to school curricula, educational postulates, division of sciences, and so on and so forth. So it's a much more broader and complex, I think, question that deals with how do we organize our societies at the end of the day and educational systems, right? Thank you. Yes.
MashaAllah, the lecture was, trying to encompass almost all the aspects which are related to economics. But you have mentioned several things, for example, the cause of this crisis. So it has been interpreted by different people variously. So some people say it was flawed because of his study of philosophy. Others say because assassins, there was some danger of assassins. But you have just given a new interpretation that it was because he criticized the rulers or the notables, so for this, and he had to leave Baghdad. So this is one point. Second is that why we could not project his economic thought globally so that it could be also taken seriously by people to think on it and make it an alternative for the materialist thought or consumerist thought, which is prevailing. So where we are lacking, is it our fault or is it fault of someone else? So why our scholars could not project Ghazali in such a way that she could become an internationally relevant global thinker of economics? So that is there. So just I want to ask these two questions.
Thank you, yeah, wonderful. To your first point on the crisis, I think it's all of the above. Yeah. I mean, indeed, scholars have pointed out that he underwent at least two spiritual or psychological crises, right? One before he left, and then the second initiated with his departure from Baghdad. And I think this is on point. He has been pondering about the role of the human, the role of Sufism as well in life, or specific in his own life. But also because he wanted to escape the current the current political context of the time, right, in Baghdad. And some would claim that his decision to leave was under the pretext to do some type of pilgrimage and to go to see other places in the Muslim world, whereby he could finally indulge in what he initially wanted. So muhasaba, really self-examination, which was impossible to do during his tenure at the Nizamiya Madrasa, right? So I think the two are actually interrelated, that the political segment is not completely disassociated from the ethical or the intellectual, for that matter, right? To your second point on the so-called the global Ghazali, I mean, very much, yes, the one way of achieving that is through translation works. For instance, Al-Ghazali has been translated in many languages. Also, there is a massive translation project going on, I think, between the publishers in the US and the UK on his opus in the English language. To my knowledge, there is also a initiative and a platform called the Ghazali Project in Indonesia with the Tazkiah College in Indonesia, and so on and so forth. So there have been incentives to include al-Ghazali's teaching in various, not only economic, but also philosophical or pedagogical frameworks, right? How, let's say, we could use al-Ghazali's thought when it comes to pedagogy, or books have been written and passages translated al-Ghazali for kids, which is a specific segment, right? So all of this, I think, points to the, and this is not to venerate a scholar too much, but I think it does point to his, one, to his excellence, and two, to his extremely broad approach to human sciences. And this is what I mean when I say his polyvalent, his multivalent approach, right, to particular sciences, which I think has been obliterated in our modern division of sciences, that what we call for in today's world is very much a specialization, that one has to specialize in a particular segment within a particular scientific field, right? And then I think we miss out on these broader human interactions that I think crucial for something like economics. I mean, in all honesty, I am not an economist myself. I'm trained in Middle Eastern Islamic studies, broadly speaking. But the economic questions that I would ask, I think, are very different than from those by an economist or a financial marketeer, right? So that's why I think that it's we're negating the human ethical aspects if we stay within our specific field, which I think might be very, very dangerous. Right?
Yes. Maybe we can just ask if our people on the Zoom, they wanted to ask, please raise your hand or write your comments. You can go ahead with our Prof. Hisham, you want to say something?
Kind of strange. We did not discuss scarcity. I mean, how do we decide? I assume during the time of Ghazali, there was a lot of poverty. There was a lot of poverty also. So the issue of the revelation comes to the Prophet at the time of in a milieu of business milieu, as the Prophet himself was a businessman. Abu Bakr was a business cloth salesman. Omar was a cloth salesman. So business was not something strange. But the introduction in Islam was actually the idea of zakat, redistribution of wealth. And you did not seem to discuss that as an important factor. The zakat was the total opposite of the tax which you were used to have in Europe, which was the from the poor to the rich, not from the rich to the poor. So all of a sudden, this suddenly changes. Zakat is from the rich to the poor. And so this concept of brotherhood in terms of economic brotherhood, that you are responsible for your brother. So what does Ghazali say about this, as you did not discuss anything of the idea of redistribution of wealth, your automatic responsibility from the rich to the poor, as such.
Thank you. These are great points. Thanks so much. Obviously, poverty existed in the Muslim world, right? Prior to modernity, I mean, there is no, absolutely, there is no, you know, no need to romanticize classical or pre-modern period. I would say, to your first point, I interpret the rise in ethical economic genre with al-Muhasibi, Ibn Abi al-Dunya, al-Isfahani, al-Ghazali, even to an extent, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyya, Ibn Taymiyyah, and so forth, the rise of these type of, or Shaybani, really beginning with al-Shaybani, 8th century, right? The rise in these type of literature, I think, has to do in part with the need for it, the need for this type of literature, the need to discuss ethical, economic points of view, not only within the development of Islamic law and legal tradition or legal discourse, but also in its own right. Because many rulers ruled with an iron fist. As you said, scarcity was an issue, poverty was an issue. Despite the relative development of the Muslim world in comparison to other parts of the world at that time, right? But I think the fact that you do end up with texts such as these point to the fact that these scholars at least implicitly wanted to point out their dissatisfaction with the society maybe in which they lived, right? On a more broader social scale. Now, more specifically to your point on distribution and zakat, extremely important indeed. And Al-Ghazali touches upon quote unquote, a book within Ihya, so a chapter on a riba and a chapter on zakat as well. Extremely important. And he confirms their role in society. So, you know, every person should give according to their ability. Percentage would obviously differ from scholar to scholar, interpretation to interpretation. But zakat would be very important because it also points to the establishment of waqf. And waqf, again, has an immense, not only, again, religious, but also social function in society, right? It was through waqf that you could finance social projects, or through waqf, you have establishment of certain institutions, pedagogical institutions, building of bridges, and so on and so forth, right? And we see what happens with the dissolution of waqf in modernity as well, in the Ottoman Empire and other places. And riba, many scholars would disagree, what exactly is riba? Is it usury or is it excessive usury? What's the nature and the boundaries of riba? Now, you know, in broad terms, Al-Ghazali is totally against riba. He says riba has to be obliterated. It points to the fact that you can have profits, gaining profit in illicit ways, unlawful ways, and so on and so forth. What I see the problem of these two categories or elements is that in the modern period, many of Muslim economists have been focusing on these two specific components within Islamic economic financial frameworks, right? And as you might well know, these have not been implemented in any society to the level of changing indeed the current socioeconomic systems on the ground, right? So this is my sort of issue, if you will, with the implementation of zakat and riba, that they have not been systematized or systematically implemented to the level of really making a difference in the modern period, right? Modern taxation.
Changes actually following zakat. From the rich to the poor, it was always from the poor to the rich.
The so-called the progressive tax system, perhaps.
Tax system itself, as you don't tax the poor that much. And the tax is redistributed. So it is actually one of the Muslim inventions in Greece that's actually adopted by the modern West.
But beyond that, right, the if we were just to focus or primarily focus on zakat and riba as to showcase, for instance, the contributions of modern contemporary Islamic economics or economics and finances, this is one of my issues that I have with that, right? That as of now, in the current socio-political climates in the Muslim world as well, and beyond, in all honesty, simply focusing on zakat and riba as to pointing out, but these are the Islamic components that, you know, go back to the classical sources or even to the religious sources of the Quran, is not enough to make a visible change in the economies of these societies, if you see what I mean, right? So absolutely, an important contribution, an important invention that goes all the way back to the foundational text, right, to the Quran. But I think much is to be done if we were really to think, how can we challenge the global economic perspective, right? Because we know that to a large extent, the Muslim majority countries have been following, they created a niche within their own economics, within their own economy, to follow the prevalent global ideas, economic ideas, right? But thank you, Jibrat. Yes.
Thank you so much for your lecture, Professor. My question is, with the over-exploitation of the earth resources and the pollution of the environment that is leading us to a climate change, which David Wallace Wells defined as an existential crisis, do humans need a dramatic change in their economic system, and how the economic philosophy of Ghazali can help us to draw a new friendly environment economics? Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. That's an excellent point as well. So Al-Ghazali does not, or any other classical scholar for that matter, does not directly, as one would expect, discuss or analyze what we would call environmental or ecological theories or ecological crisis per se. But I think that his approach is very much in line with these type of thinking. In other words, that ecology or environment is inextricably related to economics. There is no way around it. Not only if you think of epistemologically how economics and ecology have common root even in ancient Greek, right? That or economics would point to oikos, right? The matter within a household, but also broadly socially and cosmologically, the two are interlinked. Economics and environment are very much interlinked. So, in other words, one of the prevalent reasons for the current ecological or environmental crisis very much has to do with economic postulates that we follow, utilization of world's natural resources and so on and so forth, right? So the two are interlinked. If we were to remedy ecology and environment, we have to remedy economics. There is no other way. And again, what can be how these teachings can be implemented along the same lines? You know, there has been an uprise in environmental humanities, as you might know, the field of environmental humanities, which is again a very, very much a multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary field. And environmental humanities has been trying to sort of challenge some of the Eurocentric perspectives of what exactly goes in, what is left out, right, in terms of theories, scholarships, traditions, and so forth. But again, much has to be done in this domain. And I do believe that perhaps environmental humanities is one way of challenging these prevalent, persisting conceptualizations or theories. In other words, include non-European, non-Western intellectual traditions, in our context, Islamic intellectual tradition, into these domains, into these scholarships, right? If they claim to be interdisciplinary, and if we look at the classical scholarship and we see that they're weaving through various fields and domains, I think it's an excellent start. Now, the question then obviously is to what extent will they be really picked up and implemented in our, let's say, policy circles, right? Or UN Charter, would they refer to scholars from, you know, non-West pre-modernity, for instance, right? But all of this is to say that there is, I think, a great potential in this field. If we were to remedy environmental ecological disasters that we as a society are facing, really it has nothing to do with Muslim majority countries per se. It has to do with global world order, right? Society at large. In the other hand, yes, we're very much in the same boat, but as we all know, I mean, those who are well off, they're not going to feel the brunt of it as, you know, those who are not well off. So absolutely, I absolutely agree with that.
I'm sorry, we have one question online from Atika Ghazali Al-Kashif, asking, it's a good question. The ideas of Al-Ghazali economic philosophy are well known among scholars and avid readers, yet their application and implications stand in contrast to the ethos of Eurocentric capitalism and hedonism. As Islamic think tank entrepreneurs, how do you propose we integrate these theories into our daily business transactions?
Thank you. Yeah, to some extent, this points to what has already been said before, but it's really the active inclusion of not only Al-Ghazali, but also other scholars from pre-modern classical part into our own curricula. And by curricula, I do not mean only within Islamic and Middle Eastern studies, but also other disciplines that are taught usually separately, economics, environmental sciences, politics, and so on and so forth. So that's on the educational level. Second is to initiate various projects also from the side of civil society that would very much include such theories yes. into their own activities. And I already mentioned the Ghazali project, but also many others that are happening across the board, not only in Euro-America, but also in the Muslim majority countries, right? So these are two possible, more accessible points of entry, in my opinion. Now, has the capacity to sort of change the economic world as we know today? Perhaps not, right? We have to be aware also of the limitations, that at the end of the day, there's always going to be certain groups of people who believe in, you know, who believe otherwise, to put it very simply. So can we all be on board and say, no, we have to implement Al-Ghazali's thought when it comes to economic thinking? I'm sure not. But the same goes for any other system, whether neoliberal capitalism or market economy or socialism. You will always have some type of rejection, to say the least, right? Now, again, on the flip side, this does not mean that we shouldn't try to the best of our ability.
Assalamu alaikum to our distinguished speaker, and salam sejahtera to our esteemed audience, and selamat petang to my fellow colleagues. Dr. Sami Al-Daghestani, I am intrigued by you mentioning Faqih as an ethical merit. Would it be possible if you could go back to your slide on Al-Ghazali's definition? Because I think the second and third sentence, I feel there is a bit of tension. I would appreciate it if you could explain a bit about that. And then also the five definitions of faqir. Could you explain a bit those five different definitions of poverty? And in view of that, would you agree that the Palestine people are a destitute people? Whereas the Saudi Arabians or the Jordanians or the Egyptians are wealthy people.
Yeah, I just want to mention this is Puan Intan. She's from IDFR's Institute of Diplomacy and Foreign Relations, Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Thank you for your questions as well. So by faqr, what Al-Ghazali is pointing out is the twofold understanding of faqr as a social or specifically financial economic poverty or spiritual poverty. Now, for social poverty, he says, to give you a practical example, he would say begging is frowned upon. One should not beg. If one is able to work, one should work. One should gain licit ways of obtaining livelihood, engage in kasb, okay? With the spiritual poverty, he says, this is actually very important. You know that many Sufis in pre-modern Muslim world engaged in faqr as a spiritual poverty, that they would, let's say, seclude themselves, that they would try to exercise the self-examination, the notion of muhasaba. So not only ilm al-mu'amala, the transactions that has to deal with people, society at large, but also that would be engaged in themselves to attain the highest truths possible, to come as close to the divine as possible, right? This is what Al-Ghazali means with the twofold perspective of spiritual versus economic poverty. Now, and these are, so the five levels of poverty that he states is as presented. So the first is the poverty of the one who renounces the world is the highest level, right? So the one who engages in zuhd is the highest level on the spiritual level, right? Second, poverty of the one who does not despise wealth, but possesses more than necessary. So you see Al-Ghazali's thinking here. You shouldn't despise wealth, but you have more than what you need, so to speak. That's on the second level for Al-Ghazali. On the third level is poverty of the one who loves wealth, but does not strive to obtain it. So you have certain inclinations, certain lust for wealth, but you're not going to necessarily obtain it, right? And on the fourth level, poverty of the greedy who desire to earn more wealth, so even more than what he or she has. And then finally, poverty of the one who strives for wants, yet has no possession of wealth. In other words, poverty of the one who desires material gain, yet has none of it. I mean, all negative, it's very difficult to account for that because it will depend on the context, in the context of the one of, quote unquote, the destitute, right? It would depend on the context of the destitute and two, again, on one's own self or niya, one's own intention. So it's not that these are all good or these are all negative. It would really, they have to be contextualized with it, within a specific social, socioeconomic, or even spiritual, intellectual frameworks, right? Now, to your point, whether we can label people of Palestine as this, you mean the second and the third point? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so poverty is not to, you mean the quote, poverty is not to possess what is necessary by removing wants, right? So you don't possess what is necessary by simply to remove the wants, to remove the desires. Not having that which is necessary, so not to have, is not considered poverty. If you don't have that which is necessary, you're not considered poor for Al-Ghazali. If you have that which is necessary, but you have a command over it, that you know how to deal with your own possessions, you're not poor. It does not necessarily pertain to food, right? Because he says on the flip side, yes. But so this is... Exactly. So this is exactly the point that in his other passages, he says the three indispensable levels are indeed food, clothing, shelter, right? So in the same breath, he would say food, clothing, shelter is sort of a must for any human being. And from this, for instance, we could deduct that the basic human right for even a modern human being would be based on these two issues. There is no life without food, right? There is no life without shelter, and there is no life without clothing. Now, are there people who engage with less food and more drinks? I'm sure they are. Are there some Sufi mystics who engage very much with zuhd and renounce the world completely? Of course, but this would not be the norm for Al-Ghazali, right? To your point on Palestine versus Saudi Arabia, one, I don't think we should generalize to that level. You know, are the Palestinians poor and the Saudis rich? I wouldn't generalize and say a society as such is poor or society as such is. And what exactly do we mean by poor? If you mean the social economic poverty, I mean, of course, the Palestinian people are people, displaced people, right? They do not have the right to their own land. So, Yes. Yes, I see what you mean. Yes. Yeah, to me this thank you. To me this really points more to the intricate problems within the Muslim world itself. That often we think of the Muslim world on a very not really pragmatic, but indeed abstract sense on Ummah, right? And on the other hand, what exactly has Saudi Arabia to do with Palestine, or how does Indonesia relate to Bosnia? We see that on practical, political, economic terms, maybe there is a lot of disagreements, right? So I think we have to maybe step back from this over general abstract notion of Ummah and be much more paying attention to localized, factual, tangible communities in the Muslim majority countries, right? And that would very much point to Palestine and Palestinian issue.
Well, it's getting more exciting. So. I just would like to comment based on also the comments of others. Sorry, I missed the first several minutes of your presentation. I just to go to the question, is Al-Ghazali's here or your case here, economic philosophy, relevant or not to the present world, which we know so much has changed since his times, of course, yeah? If he were to be alive today, what would he be repeating his own year or whatnot? I think he still presents his year as the right philosophy, as the right way of life for humanity. After all, as we understand the content of the year, it is a restatement. It's a restating basically the teaching, the life, the sunnah of the Prophet. So it is going to be relevant at all times, precisely because for that reason, it is relevant. But it takes a lot to convince people. It's very, very difficult to convince people that the life, the way of life opted, the exalted opted, is the kind of life that humanity should have. But we may start, yeah? And certain, for this, for example, the question of when you use the word poverty, there's bound to be misunderstanding because we understand the term differently today, yeah? Whereas Al-Ghazali and Sufis, basically it's a Sufi terminology, this poverty, fakir, yeah? So to be a fakir, I mean, that is contrary to what the government of the day today is, the president, prime minister of Malaysia wants to abolish poverty. And that Al-Ghazali says, no, poverty is good. So obviously he means different thing, yeah? I think, well, we all understand he means spiritual poverty. But what do you mean by spiritual poverty? It is the highest, at the highest level, poverty at the highest level is that spiritual poverty in which when we realize, it is a spiritual realization. It is a realization that you don't own anything. That, it sounds simple, yeah? So if we come to that realization that in reality we own nothing, then we have realized the meaning of spiritual poverty. I think that is important. But then, is that concept, is concept of spiritual poverty anti-wealth? No, it is not anti-wealth. To be spiritual, to be a fakir, poor in that sense, in the spiritual sense, is not necessarily anti-wealth. You can be a millionaire, and yet inwardly you are a fakir. Once I came across a Sufi sheikh in Western Sufi sheikh, when he said that nowadays in order to be spiritually poor, you have to be physically rich. Because the conditions of the human life, you know, there's no way that how to survive in order to be poor, to be poor. What more is deliberately to be poor? This is a deliberation to be poor. Yeah, I thought, yeah, when I reflected, yeah, there's some truth in that. Yeah, If you want to do spend a lot of time of dhikr, I mean, well, you get your income and so on. You have to work. Yeah. But we understand what that means. But there are many things in the book, in the yeah, for example, basically, yeah, it is a philosophy, economic philosophy, but of course he didn't write that. That was not his intention. He did not intend when he wrote yeah that he wanted to write an economic philosophy. But the kind of life he was advocating or he was obtaining has economic implications. That is important. Economic implication. So I think, let's say, for example, to live that wasatiya way of life, to be of the middle path. That's what the kind of life that you opted. So it is, I think it is... it is difficult, but it is possible, and it is something necessary. Anti ways, for example, all the things that you presented, that is precisely the kind of order, the moral order that we want to see. But then we cannot change people that without us changing certain things within us. Sometime back here in this room, we talk about, you cannot change the world without changing what is inside us. So Al-Ghazali, he left his job, prestigious job in the university, prestigious university in Baghdad. It shocks the people there. It shocks the people. It shocks the professors, the other professors. It shocks all the rulers that he has left because he was opting for another way of life, and actually he said admitted, yeah, because when he left that, he said he was worldly, he was crazy and for fame and so on. He did not want that. He abandoned that life, yeah. So he went for a life of seclusion, but that's not the end. He did not spend entire life living in seclusion. What's the lesson that we can learn from that? He left teaching, right, and later came back to teaching. To me, the lesson is that at first, because he wanted to change himself into a new person, he has to leave the world, in a sense. Left the world and concentrated on spiritual life. But then, when that became that kind of life, the values that became is kind of now his second nature. He can say, I can come back to the world. We can come back to the world. I'm not going to be changed by that world. He's going to change that world. I think this is a very, very, very important thing that can be learned from it. So it's relevant.
No, absolutely. Thank you so much for this comment, Professor. You're right. He engages in Zuhd very much, but he stays connected. He reaches out to people. There are letters of Al-Ghazali that he wrote to officials during his time in Damascus, in Jerusalem, in other places. And finally, he comes back to Tus, Khorasan, engages in teaching very much locally. So he teaches us that Kasb is important, Zuhd is important, but not being fully secluded, coming back into society, right, at the end of the day. Now, his project, the way I see it, is, I mean, as the title itself implies, is the revival of the religious sciences that were already lost at his time, right? He already thought that certain sciences have been lost, certain approaches to light have been lost already in 12th century. What he wants to do is to revive them, to bring them back to life. Now, I think we're dealing with two different epistemologies if we think about what is the bulk of his project in 12th century and what are we dealing today with neoliberal globalization or economic globalization, right? These are two different epistemologies. Can they be... You know, are they complementary? I do not think so, right? They go head to head for the most time. They bump into each other. But to your point and in relation to that, on the notion of faqr as spiritual poverty, I think our modern debates on poverty are very much, obviously, they're anti-poverty, right? People want to do war against poverty. We have to eliminate poverty. We have to disperse poverty and so on. But looking into Al-Ghazali, I think he would say, no, it's the opposite. We have to wage war against the riches, not against poverty necessarily, right? I mean, we have poverty because of the riches to begin with, right? So these two are obviously interconnected, but they can also go against each other. And I think this is what his epistemology really brings forth. It's the notion of spiritual poverty is key, but wealth and riches is something that has to be tackled on a systematic, societal, structural level, right?
Very good.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Big thank you to Dr. Al-Dikistani for the presentation. I've got some questions. I'm very intrigued by the transition from Homo sapiens to Homo economicus. I think this is a very compelling nature of the human being where we need wealth in order to sustain ourselves, but at the same time, we have to renounce it for spiritual elevation. So my first question perhaps has been answered. How would Al-Ghazali think about and contend with our current economic climate, the rise of commercial banking in far-flung lands across the globe? I think that has been dealt with. My question now is with regards to deeds as being dependent on intentions. Innamal a'malu binniyah. Does it also stand for a current suggestion for the availability of loans for the performing of Hajj? Because recently there was an article that came out about institutions like Andalusia and Bank of Islam who are trying to promote the taking of loans to perform Hajj. So, you know, going on Hajj as a pillar of Islam, we know that it is only for those who can afford it. So how do we deal with such a situation? The next question is with regards to Islamic finance as a whole or Islamic banking. Is it merely a pacifier for Muslims in dealing with commercial banks? Because we see the stifling of dissenters, for example, the likes of, you know, the example of Darul Arkam here in Malaysia, a self-sustaining kind of organization that dealt with the economy in a very insular way, but was stifled by the authorities. And also, I can't remember the name of this Indonesian man who was jailed for attempting to reintroduce the dinar in Indonesian society a couple of years ago. So how do we contend with such issues, and is there a way out according to Al-Ghazali? Thank you very much.
Thank you for your questions. Niyyah is obviously, I mean, extremely important, but also very tricky, right? Because who are we as fellow members of society to judge someone according to his or her niyyah? This is something that it's beyond us, right? It's not up to us to judge. However, having said that, a good intention before a deed, especially in the context of financial economics sort of institution, I think is crucial for Al-Ghazali, that it starts with the niyyah. What exactly is your intention with it? How are you going to engage with a economic or financial transaction? Has a lot to do with your intentionality. To what end are you doing that for, right? Is it to gain money, for instance, on its own? Or does it have a benefit to yourself? Are you perhaps helping your community, your society, your family? Or is it perhaps that you just want money to circulate? So it really depends on what is the functionality, what is the intention of that, right? Now, specifically to your point on loans and Hajj, I would say it would fall into this category that Al-Ghazali is putting forward. But to give you a very interesting example, I recently talked to a Saudi economist who is exploring the option of having a so-called baby bonds, right? Bonds that start with babies are born, that would be based on certain type of investment for people to initially or eventually be able to perform either Umrah or Hajj. And if they decided not to do so, they could still use the money for whatever their private educational means and so forth. So it's sort of a win-win situation, right? I think it's a very good idea. Whether it will be put in practice, and again, you don't know. Is there an option for it? Absolutely. But I think this is how we should think about it. If you have a specific amount of money that affords you to perform the Hajj pilgrimage or the Umrah, and you can see that neither you or your immediate community, your immediate family is suffering because of it, then probably Al-Ghazali would say, but by all means, you know, go for it. If, however, there are other more important, more pressing issues on the ground, I think these, obviously, without saying, take precedent, right? So they should be addressed first before you engage into, let's say, taking a loan or even thinking or pondering upon performing a Hajj, even though it is a religious obligation. But as we all know, it comes with a for a specific,
specific cost,
right? First, you have to deal with whatever is in your vicinity. And this is what I mean with, again, the notion of Ummah being too abstract, that sometimes we're thinking about miles and miles, thousands of miles ahead without really addressing the issues in our own community or with our own family, right? I think it really starts with looking into your own self, starting with the self, and then you probably expand the diameter, you know, as long as you can get it. But you start with the, you start with the nafs. You start with the nafs. Right? As to your point on Islamic finance, now I'm not a specialist in Islamic finance and banking, but I have been fairly critical of modern Islamic economics and finance. To an extent, I see it as a hybrid system, to be fair, as a hybrid system of resorting to certain Islamic, basic Islamic tenets, religious texts, but also very much being a niche within the current global economic system, right? I mean, there is no denial that the two cannot be fully separated. They operate within each other, or at least for the Islamic economic financial system, to a large extent, it still operates within the global system. And that's what I mean when I say that the elements of zakat and riba, they have not changed the outcomes in these specific countries, Muslim majority countries, that would be really testifying to the independent economic or financial frameworks outside of the current global system, right? Now, on the other hand, are they certain institutions and mechanisms and tools that are very much valuable and viral? Yes, I do believe so. And can they be sort of theorized even further? Yes. So I do believe that there is a potential also for even a further potential for Islamic economics and finance. But as of now, thinking about its sort of intellectual legacy, I see that to some extent, many Muslim economists of the day have not critically assessed the very terms in which they operate. They take the terms at face value, starting with economics, starting with finance, and so on and so forth, right? So what I think intellectual history of Islam teaches us sort of is that we have to challenge the very terms and the concepts in which we're dealing. Because for Al-Shaybani and Ibn Abi al-Dunya and Al-Ghazali, Kasb and Iqtisad have a very different connotation than what we mean with Iqtisad al-Islam today. There was no such thing as Iqtisad al-Islam in the pre-modern world, right? There is no Islamic economics. And yet it was present. It was to be found in text and probably on the ground as well, maybe through Hizbah, right?
Yeah, I think better you add on the two specific ones.
Thank you, Doctor, for your discussion. I have a question. It's kind of a hypothetical question. So in what way would a Ghazalian economic system differ from the current capitalist system? Because there are clearly worldview differences between the two paradigms, right? So how would these differences manifest in practical terms? For example, like in the case of environment or how we deal with labor, how labor is exploited today. How would this translate or manifest? And the reason I'm curious about this is because, as you said, in terms of Islamic banking and finance, when we look at the theories, we see lots of discussion about Islamic values and ethics and all that. But in terms of practice, we see that the industry has assimilated into the neoliberal paradigm rather than being something distinct. So I'm kind of curious about how the views of Ghazali or the principles of Ghazali that you're talking about, how they would be in terms of in practical, and I know that it's like a very broad question, but just for example, if we had two identical villages side by side, one run by the secular capitalist system, the other by a Ghazalian view, how would they differ? Maybe you can focus on maybe a couple of fundamental differences. Thank you.
Thank you for that. So the starting point is the self-examination. or not maybe the self-examination in terms of muhasaba, but you start with the self, right? Al-Ghazalian system, meaning you deal with ethical psychology, you deal with tasawwuf, you deal with philosophical principles, you deal with maqasid al-sharia. So you deal with a lot, with an array of theories and tools that you do not find in the current system, financial economic system, right? When it comes to the economics as a self-standing field, I think thinking along the line with Ghazali would say, but there is no such thing as economics to begin with. There is no such thing as a self-standing discipline economics. It's a human science. It has to do with human endeavors. It has to do with ethical predispositions and also possibly numbers. I mean, you do have to compete, right? And you have to compute, and you do have to sell, and you have to buy, and so forth, right? You have to engage in market transactions. But it has to do first and foremost with the ethical predispositions, not necessarily with mathematical deductivism, right? So even if we take someone like Adam Smith, who is regarded as the father of modern economics, I think that Smith has been, I would tend to say, misread by the Chicago School and other economists as the father of modern economics. This is the invisible hand. There is no interference of the government. But really, I mean, there are several works that Smith, for instance, produced, right? And it's The Wealth of Nation, but it's also The Moral Sentiments. And I think the two have to be read in tandem, for instance. So you will see that Smith, for instance, was trained as a moral philosopher, first and foremost. So arguably, one could say that Adam Smith has more in common with pre-modern classical theories than with how modern economics is defined today. But there has been a political will also to use him or to label him as a modern economist because of the notion of the invisible hand and so forth. So Al-Ghazali already points out to the forces of supply and demand few centuries prior to Adam Smith, right? He points out to the notion of invisible hand, but it's really the hizbah. I haven't had time really to discuss in detail hizbah, but think of hizbah as an institution of governmental authority of sorts that differs from place to place, era to era, right? Hizbah in 12th century Baghdad is different than hizbah in Andalusia in other centuries, right? But it points to the fact that when possible injustice occurs in the market or that somebody is jacking up the prices, only then would the muhtasib, the public inspector, would engage or would interfere. So on one hand, yes, it does point to the fact that the government is not being involved, but also that it's involved when there is a need for it, right? So it's not this sort of black and white, a very libertarian approach where there is no governmental involvement, or a very conservative approach. I think it really depends on the, again, on the context, right?
Okay, we conclude? Okay, so I think the very key word for today is balance. And as in today's rapidly evolving global economy, the quest for balance takes on heightened significance. And we see that in the modern world, which emphasizes on stability, equitable, a distribution, a resilience to shocks, the Muslim world, particularly through the lens of Al-Ghazali, teaching underscores the importance of moderation, ethical conduct, and social science, justice. And we should start, I mean, if we see it as a dream in the contemporary world, we need to start within ourselves. So each of you are the agents of Al-Ghazali, and we start from there for moving it towards governance and the global world. We thank very much Dr. Sami Al-Daghestani for his valuable inputs. And yeah, now I think it's we should.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you, everybody, for participating. And there's a souvenir session.
I thank our people who are on the Zoom and YouTube channel. Thank you very much for participating. We'll see you, inshallah, in our next lecture. Very good.